The Lady's Delight by Emile Zola, dramatized by Carine Adler. Paris, October 1865. Denise Bourdoux and her two brothers arrived at the Gare Saint-Lazare on the Cherbourg train, after a night spent on the bench of a third-class carriage. Denise, small for her age and dressed in mourning clothes, held Pepe by the hand, while Jean, splendid in the blush of his 16 years, walked behind.
Oh, I know, my darling. Shh, 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 shh. Be patient.
How far is it to Uncle's?
I don't know. Will you ask the way, Jean?
Please, sir. The Rue de la Machurière. The buildings. Aren't they tall?
Jean, don't dawdle. Stay close to me.
You all right, Denise?
I'm worried, Jean.
Why?
We had to leave Alonia so quickly, I didn't have time to write to Uncle.
He doesn't know we're coming.
No, but I'm sure he'll take us in. I don't know what we'll do if he doesn't. Ask again, Jean.
Rue de la Michaudière, please, sir.
Carry on until you get to the Place d'Orléans.
I'm tired.
Here, take the basket, Jean. I'll carry Pepe.
I'm tired too, Denise. I didn't sleep all night.
Well, nor did I. But we'll be there soon. Oh, look at that, Jean.
Now that's what I call a shop.
They were in front of a huge draper shop, its brightly coloured displays gleaming in the soft, pale October light.
It's beautiful.
Where are you weren't as big.
The high doors overlooking the Place Gaillon, made entirely of glass and surrounded with gilded sculptures, reached up to the first floor. Two figures, laughing women with bare breasts thrust forward, were unrolling a scroll bearing the inscription,
"The Lady's Delight."
That's nice. I bet that draws in the crowds.
But Denise was gazing at the mountain of cheap goods displayed on the pavement to attract the women going past.
Look, they're selling mittens for 5 sous. Tartans for 1 franc.
Come on, let's go.
Oh, wait a minute. I want to look at this window display. Oh, the velvets and the satins are amazing. Oh, and they've got silks in every colour of the rainbow. There's the Paris Bonheur. Oh, it's a wonderful new silk. Everyone's talking about it. And they're selling it for only 5 francs 90.
Hurry up, Denise.
Oh, heavens. I forgot all about Uncle.
Excuse me, sir. Rue de la Machurière.
Oh, you're in it.
So, Uncle's shop must be here. Somewhere.
There it is, Denise.
Across the road, Denise noticed the washed-out sign, Drapery Bourdoux. The house, coated with rusty paint, looked quite dilapidated next to the surrounding buildings. Through the deep and dusty windows, the merchandise could hardly be seen. The shop door seemed to lead into the darkness of a cellar.
Oh, let's go in.
Now.
Hold my hand, Pepe. Monsieur Bourdoux?
That's me.
Oh, thank goodness. I'm Denise.
Hello, Uncle.
And this is my brother Jean. Mm-hmm. And that's Pepe. We're here.
What do you mean? What do you mean you're here?
I'm sorry, Uncle, but I am...
You're supposed to be in Valognes. Why aren't you in Valognes?
Because since Father and Mother died, I haven't been able to earn enough to keep us. So when a gentleman offered Jean an apprenticeship in Paris, I followed him. I thought that Pepe and I, we'd manage somehow.
Oh dear, oh dear. Elizabeth, Genevieve, come down, quick!
Denise didn't mention Jean's love affair. Letters written to the young daughter of a nobleman. Kisses exchanged over a wall. Quite a scandal.
What is it, dear?
Madame Bourdoux was small and exhausted by anemia. Her daughter, Genevieve, had even less colour than her mother. She looked like a plant which had grown in the dark.
Oh, poor children. They must be exhausted.
Please, sit down, cousin. Oh, thank you. Oh, come on my lap, Pepe.
Oh, what a sweet little boy.
He's always so quiet.
Oh, yes, Auntie. He never makes a noise. Sometimes he goes for whole days without saying a word.
Oh.
Now, listen to me, Denise. I wrote, it's true, but that was a year ago. And since then, business hasn't been going well. Oh, it'll pass. But for the moment, I've had to reduce my staff. So, you see, I can't possibly take you on, my poor girl. It wouldn't be good for you or for us.
I'm sorry, Uncle. Don't worry. We'll go.
I'm not going to turn you away. Now you're here, you might as well stay the night. Tomorrow, we'll see.
Oh, so, everything's settled. Jean has his board and lodging, and as for Pepe, well, Madame Gras can take care of him. She only charges 40 francs for full board.
I can pay the first month, but I have to find work.
No one's hiring at the moment, except for that scoundrel Octave Mouret.
Father, I heard Vancar was looking for a sales girl.
Good idea. We'll go and see him after lunch.
Oh, yes.
It won't take long.
The family were seated in the cramped dining room at the back of the shop. A single window opened on a gloomy courtyard, which communicated with the street by a dark alleyway at the side of the house. And this courtyard, damp and filthy, was like the bottom of a well, into which fell a circular glimmer of light. Baudou carved a piece of cold veal, weighing each meagre portion at a glance within an ounce.
Come on, Baron. Come and eat.
Sorry, sir. I'm putting away the flannels.
There's a time and a place for everything, Colin.
Yes, sir.
We have to make room. Come on, squeeze together. Sit here, Jean.
Here, Uncle.
Come next to me, Pepe.
So, Denise, tell me, why didn't you get married in Boulogne?
Me? Married, Uncle? No man would want a girl like me. Anyway, I promised I'd never get married because of my brothers.
You're wrong. A woman always needs a man. Take Genevieve and Condon. If the winter season goes well, they'll be married in spring. Isn't that so, Colomban?
Yes, sir.
You see, Denise, it's the tradition in this shop for the first assistant to marry the employer's daughter. And once business improves, I'll hand the shop over to Genevieve and Colombin. Oh, Jean's finished already.
Your uncle.
Now, there's a lad with a good appetite. Come on, eat up, Denise. The sooner we get to Vancouver, the better. Jobs are hard to come by nowadays.
Vancouver's shop was in the Rue Neuve de Petit Champ. It was clean and light, but small and poorly stocked.
Good afternoon, Vancar.
Afternoon, monsieur.
Baudou. Hey, have you heard the latest? That idiot Barbara's come a cropper.
No, not him too.
Yep, he's ruined. Of course, I knew it would happen. His shop's right next to the Delight.
That wretched shop will destroy us all.
Yeah, well, not me. I'm selling up.
No, Vancar. Us small shopkeepers must stick together.
Anyway, what can I do for you today?
I've come to introduce you to my niece.
Monsieur.
She's been working in the provinces, and as I know, you're looking for a good sales girl.
Oh, well, no, not anymore. Someone took the job about 10 minutes ago.
Oh, your bad luck.
Look, you won't like it, Baudou, but...
Well, what about the Delight?
I've heard they're hiring in the ladies' department.
In there? With them?
Oh, what's she got to lose? If I was you, I'd take her to see Madame O'Reilly in the morning.
On the way back, Baudou didn't say a word to his niece. He walked fast, as if lost in thought, forcing her to run after him. He was about to enter his shop when a shopkeeper beckoned him over. It was old Bourras.
Hey, Baudou!
What is it, my friend?
Old Bourras sold walking sticks and umbrellas, which he had lined up in the window of his shop. Denise was surprised at the appearance of the building, which was squashed between the Lady's Delight and the magnificent Hotel du Villard.
I've just received a letter from my landlord. Mouret wants to buy the building!
We must be ready for anything nowadays.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.